coming up. We'll begin this morning as we normally do, which is a reminder of the real reason that we are here. And that, of course, is the fact that the Word of God is alive and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit, of the joints and the marrow. It's a critic of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. All scriptures God breathed, it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, so that the man and woman of God may become mature, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Therefore, we are here to study, to show ourselves approved unto God, workmen that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Turn in the word of truth this morning to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. As many of you know, we've been taking a break during the holiday season. We've done a special on the Thanksgiving holiday season, a service, and we're doing a special on Christmas, and I'm going to probably continue this until Wednesday evening, where we'll probably wrap it up by then and continue our study on Friday. Don't forget, Friday's New Year's Day, but we will be having service. What better way to start off the New Year's than gather together with the people of God? So we've been noting a Christmas special on what we call the paradox of Christmas. And I'd like to wrap up this special by introducing to you what I have developed from what I believe is the greatest passage in the Word of God when it comes to the true meaning of Christmas. You might think that the greatest passage would be found in the Gospels, such as Luke chapter 2, great passage. But I think the greatest passage of all throughout the Word of God is Philippians chapter 2 when it comes to the true meaning of what Christmas is all about. And so we're going to begin in Philippians chapter 2, especially we're going to focus in on, if you look at verses 5 through 11, I'm entitling this particular message, I call it the 5 A's. The 5 A's, and bear with me as I introduce it to you, but something that I put together that I think you're going to enjoy. 5, I like using that number because 5 is the number for grace, and we have tremendous manifestations of the grace of God in Philippians chapters 2, 5 through 11. The first A is going to be called abandonment. We're going to deal with that in Philippians chapter 2 in verse 6. I'll identify this for you in just a moment. The second A will be the word acceptance. The third one is association. The fourth one is adoption. The fifth one is ascension. So we have abandonment, Philippians 2, 6, acceptance, Philippians 2, 7, association, Philippians 2, 8, his adoption in Philippians 2, 8 as well, and then his ascension in Philippians 2, 9 through 11. Let's take the first one. Why do I come up with the word abandonment? Well, in Philippians chapter 2, I'm going to add a little bit of corrected translation to this to make it a little bit clearer for you, but this is basically from the original language. It says that he actually abandoned something when, although he existed in the exact form of God, notice that, he wasn't like God, he existed in the exact form of God. He is God. And although he existed in the exact form of God, he did not regard his equality with God a thing to be grasped or a thing to claim. In other words, he was willing to abandon who he was as God in the sense of being worshiped as God. He was willing to abandon that and come down from heaven. He left the throne of heaven, and he came down from heaven to abandon the deity that existed as it did in eternity past before the creation of the Lord Jesus Christ. He abandoned that to come down on this earth to do something for you and I. And what did he do? He became a member of the human race. And so the first thing he did is that although he existed in the exact form of God, he was willing to abandon that particular function. He did not regard his equality with God a thing for him to be grasped or a thing for him to claim. In other words, he was willing to abandon his rights as God so that he could become a man. The second one is acceptance. If you look at Philippians 2, 7, this is when he accepted the fact that he would deny himself. He didn't empty himself. That's a terrible translation. So if you have that cross it out. It is not what the Word of God teaches. It means he denied himself of the proper functions of his deity. In other words, he was willing to give up his omnipotence. He was willing to give up his omniscience. He was willing to give up all the attributes that God had to become a man. And so he actually, when he accepted the role of becoming a man, he accepted the fact that he would deny himself of the proper function of his deity, or deny himself of his being equal to God. How? By taking the form of a bondservant. In fact, he didn't just become a member of the human race. He took the form of a bondservant, and he was made in the likeness of men. Now, why does it say that he was made in the likeness of men? Does that mean he wasn't equal to man? Not at all. It says he was made in the likeness of men because he was minus one thing that man had, and that was what? The old sin nature. He's the only member of the human race ever born without an old sin nature. So he accepted that role as a part of the plan of God. And then the third one is association. Now he's willing to associate with something. What did he associate with? Well, association in Philippians 2:8, it deals with the fact when he associated with the humanity by willing to be discovered in outward appearance as a man, and was willing to humble himself by becoming obedient to the point of his spiritual death, that is his death on the cross. Then we're going to see the fourth one. We'll note more of these in detail in our study, adoption. And he actually has a principle of adoption when he received his new place among God and all of God's creatures. Both in the angelic and the human form, he actually was elevated above all angels, elevated above all members of the human race, when God exalted him to the maximum. That's Philippians 2, verses 9 through 11, by the way, when God exalted him to the maximum and bestowed on him not a name, but a title. Or the word name is a good translation, but if you recognize that the word name means a title or a rank, which is above every title or every name or every rank. Then the fifth one is ascension. Ascension is Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 through 11, when he ascended into his new office, his new rank, his new dignity, where now every knee should bow and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Now, all of these principles that I just gave you, these five principles, have a paradox within it. And my main working definition of a paradox is as follows. A paradox can say two things that seem to be opposite, or two things that seem to be contradictory, but there's an important truth or unity in both of them. As Jason mentioned with the word dying and life, death coming out of life or life coming out of death, etc. So a paradox can say two things that seem to be opposite, or they seem to contradict themselves, but there's an important truth or unity in both of them. Now I'm going to give you my corrected translation again that I gave you on Friday, Wednesday, for our Christmas Eve, Christmas celebration Eve service, by the way. But Philippians chapter 2, let's begin with verse 1, and let's go through this. I'm going to give you my corrected translation from the original language, but it should be a little bit clearer. Again, it says in Philippians 2:1, Paul's writing, one of the reasons why I think this is the greatest passage in the Bible about the Christmas celebration. Here's what Paul wrote. He said, "Since therefore there is encouragement in Christ," and since is, by the way, the word if is the Greek word there is ei, and it means since and there is. So since and there is encouragement in Christ, since and there is comfort from having God's virtue love, which is love for God, then love for yourself and love for others, and since and there is fellowship with the Spirit, and since there is tendernesses and compassions, Paul writes to the Philippians, he says, "Bring to my completion," or bring to my inner happiness in your life, "by thinking the same doctrines, maintaining the same virtue love, with unity in your soul, concentrating on the same objective, which is the glorification of the Lord Jesus Christ, which is why we have been created." And then he goes on to say in verse 3, here's what we do. "Doing nothing motivated by contentiousness or ambitious pride, but with humility of mind." That means by means of thinking in grace, by means of grace orientation, "let each of you keep on considering one another as more" what? important than himself. This is the mind of Christ. He goes on to say, do not merely be regarding your own personal interest, but also regard or care or consider the personal interest of others. Then here's the commandment. Here's the challenge. Keep on thinking this. Keep on thinking this type of doctrine within yourselves, which same doctrine was also resident in Christ Jesus. Then it goes on to say in my translation I just gave you a few moments ago, who, although he existed in the form of God, he was the exact nature of God himself. He did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but instead, Philippians 2:7, he did not empty himself of his deity, but it says he denied himself of the proper functions of his deity or of being equal to God. How? How did he do that? Verse 7, by taking, he says, in fact, although having been discovered in outward appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of spiritual death, that is the death of the cross. Very, very important. Therefore, the Bible says, therefore also the God has highly exalted him to the maximum, bestowed on him the name or the rank which is above every name, so that by means of his name, his office, his rank, and dignity belonging to Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. And then he goes on to say, my final verse, every tongue should confess. What will every tongue do? Confess or acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Now, if you were here on Friday evening, remember there are four major confessions in the Christian way of life. We confess Christ at salvation. In Romans chapter 10, verse 9, it says, if you confess with your mouth, if you say that Jesus Christ is Lord and you believe in your heart, you will be saved. That's the most important homo legeo or confession. Then number two, there's rebound. If we confess our what? Sins. Now we're in fellowship with God. The third confession, his exaltation. Do we actually acknowledge that he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Is he exalted in your life? If Jesus Christ, you've heard the phrase, and there's some truth to it, if Jesus Christ is not Lord of all in your life, he's really not Lord at all. If he's not number one priority, then therefore you've got something else ahead of him, and that's not exalting him in your life. That's why I love this passage. It's a challenge of how to live once we recognize who he is. And then the final confession, this is the one I love the most, by the way, which talks about our rewards. Remember? If we become winner believers, what does he do? He confesses our name. Before his Father and before his angels, he says your name before the Father and before the angels, confesses you as a winner believer, and then you receive rewards because you've honored all principles I just gave you when it comes to the principle of confession. So there's a few principles that emerge as we begin this passage. First of all, I want you to go to Hebrews chapter 1, look at verse 3 for a moment. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3 is a very important passage because you have to understand that Jesus Christ was and still is the exact representation of God. Do you know that there's teachings that are out today that say he is not the exact representation of God? They call him a little God. They take away who he really is. They say, well, you know, he's a lesser God than God the Father. They don't even include God the Holy Spirit many times in the function when they actually try to say who is equal, the Father or the Son. They leave out the Spirit most of the time. But notice, our Lord was still and is the exact representation of God. That's why Hebrews 1:3 says this, he is the radiance of his glory. If you want to see the rays of the glory of God, you can see it in Jesus Christ. And remember, you can see that in his human nature. Remember what he said to Philip when Philip said, show us the way. And Jesus Christ said, I am the way and I am the truth and I am the life. And then Philip said, well, show us the Father. He said, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. Why? Because he is the exact representation of the glory of God. So Hebrews 1:3 says he's the radiance of his glory. He is the exact representation of his nature, talking about God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. and he upholds all things by the word of his power. See, that seems to be a paradox. How can you be human and also be a God or be the God? It seems to be a contradiction. It seems to be a paradox, but it's not. When Jesus Christ became a man, he didn't subtract anything from being God. He added humanity to God. That's what he did. He added the human nature to become a part of God. That's why it's very interesting that only church-age believers are said to be members of the body of Christ. He is the head, and we are what? His body. That was never said about the Old Testament saints, nor will it ever be said about the tribulation of believers or the believers in the millennial reign. But it's said about the church age believer for a very interesting reason, as I'll show you if we get that far this evening. So the first principle is that our Lord still is the exact representation of God. The second principle I want you to see, now go back to the Gospel of John, chapter 5. Is that he is totally the same exact essence of God, which is why you have to worship him as God. He also possessed the same exact essence of God. Jesus Christ made the statement in John 5, 22 and 23. He said this. I love the sound of those pages, so let me hear them. All judgment has been given to the Son in that order that all may what? All may honor the Son even as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son like they honor the Father does not honor the Father who sent him. Therefore, the principle is simple. If you do not honor and respect and worship the Lord Jesus Christ, again, you will not. If you do not honor and respect the Lord Jesus Christ as you do God the Father, you are not worshiping God. And that leads me to this point that I want you to see. In fact, I brought you to the Gospel of John, but go to the end of the Bible, go to 2 John, the epistle, right after 1 John. This was such a serious doctrinal error in the early church because they did not honor Jesus Christ as God. The Apostle John warned us about a certain group called the Gnostics who said that Jesus Christ was just like a mirage, as it were, and that now he is no longer in human form. Once again, they attack his deity. But yet Jesus Christ himself said, I and the Father are one, and we are the same. And to say that he was just a mirage and that he no longer exists as a member of the human race and that he's not alive anymore is to deny what our life is all about. It's to deny the resurrection. Because the Bible teaches if Jesus Christ was not raised from the dead, none of us will be raised from the dead. And there are people that actually say he's not raised from the dead because he no longer exists in human form. Such a serious doctrine. Here's what the Apostle John wrote, one of his last books. He wrote this in 2 John 1, beginning with verse 9. In fact, I think he said this to the elect individual called the elect lady that's going to be coming up. But look at verse 9. Now, this is a warning that John gave the early believers at Ephesus. He said, anyone who goes too far... There's always people that have to go way beyond what the Bible says and add things to the Word of God. Revelation 22, 17 and 18 says, people will be under a curse if they add to the Word of God or if they take away from the Word of God. So when he says, anyone who goes too far and does not abide in the teaching of who? Of Christ. He does not have God. The one who abides in the teaching, he has both the Father and the what? Son, if you abide in the teaching of Christ, you have both the Father and the Son. And to do that, you have to be filled with the Spirit, so the Holy Spirit is automatically considered to be a part of this particular function. Verse 10 now. If anyone comes to you, and I dedicate this to those of you who especially don't have enough doctrine to defend your faith, when you get a knock on the door from one of those Jehovah Witnesses or people who are trying to convert you, don't let them into your house, the Bible says. They will confuse you. 2 John 1:10, if anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, do not what? Do not receive him into your house and do not even give him a greeting. We tend to think that we've got to give everyone a greeting just because they say they're Christians, when in reality, the Bible says, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, and he'll say, depart from me, I never knew you. Just because they use the name of Jesus, that doesn't mean they're following the same Jesus that we follow. So if anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, don't receive him into your house and do not even give him a greeting. Why? For the one who gives him a greeting participates in his evil what? deeds. A very serious statement. You participate in their evil deeds. And what do? They deny the fact that the Father and the Son are one and the same, the exact same essence. Different personalities, but the exact same essence. So that's a very serious passage that I want you to see. And I want you to go back now to our main passage in Philippians 2. Look at what it says in verse 6 again as we now continue with what I really like to call this part of the message, the He Is part, as we're going to see when we close. But Philippians chapter 2, verse 6 says, although He existed in the form of God, the original language says, although He existed in the exact nature of God Himself, He did not regard being equal with God a thing to be grasped. He didn't say, I want to claim my deity. I want everyone to honor me as God. No, He didn't even claim that. He says, the Son of Man came to seek and save those who were lost. He came to serve, not to be served. Although we serve Him now, but we do that willingly, not because we're commanded to do so or forced to do so. We do it with a willing heart because we want to serve Him to reveal our gratitude for all He's done for us, which we have a lot to be grateful for as we close out 2015. Just the fact that we still exist as a nation should be a tremendous blessing of gratitude we should have, that we have not been self, that we haven't destroyed ourselves as of now. But this means when He says, though He existed in the form of God, He did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped. This means our Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ, He did not cling to the fact that He was God, and He did not claim His privileges of being God a thing to be grasped or something to hold on to. Now think about it. Remember when Satan came to Jesus and He was in the wilderness, and Satan said, if you be the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. He could have turned those stones into bread. He could have turned Satan into bread. He could have done anything, but that would be using His power. He did not use His power, because if He used His power, then He could not say, live like I do. Because we don't have the power of God as such. We don't have omnipotence. We're not all powerful. We don't have omniscience, having all knowledge. He didn't even use His omniscience. He knew there were times that God allowed Him to, but basically He had to operate in faith just like everyone else. Because if He was anything more than man, then He couldn't expect man to follow His commands, because it would be an impossible command for man to follow. We can't be like that. We can operate as He operated and become an example as He was to us, but ultimately we are not God. So Jesus Christ had to become a man to reveal to mankind how mankind could worship and honor the Father. That's why He did not cling to the fact that He was God. He gave up His rights so that He could show us that there's a way to God, that He's the way, He's the truth, and He's the life. His yoke is easy, His burden is light, and He says, if I can do it, so can you. So much so that Paul the Apostle made that statement in Philippians 4:13. He says, I can do all things. How many things? All things through Him who keeps on strengthening me. What a thing He gave up. Remember that. He gave up His deity. And instead, in verse Philippians 2:7, again, it does not say He emptied Himself. It says He denied Himself of the proper function of His deity. He denied Himself of His proper function of being equal to God. How did He do that? The next thing He did is He operated in what we call the theology behind Christmas. What did He do? Look at verse 7. By taking the form of a bondservant, being made in the likeness of men. And let me remind you again, being found in appearance as a man in verse 8, He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to what? To the death of the cross. He became humbled and to the death of the cross. This is really called the theology behind Christmas, the doctrine that really Christmas is all about. If we just squeeze all of these verses together, you will find out it's pretty clear that we're talking about one who is God. That's how it starts. But He is also Lord, and that's how it ends. Look at verses 9 through 11, when it says that at the name in verse 10, at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is what? He's Lord. This, we are talking about the fact that He's God in Philippians 2, 5 through 7. That's how it starts. And then He ends up to be Lord. And that's how it ends. And with all of that in mind, that tells us that's the real meaning of this passage. It's a passage with unapproachable majesty, unless you understand the difference between God, the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ, and man, the humanity of Jesus Christ, caught together. And what is that called in theology? The doctrine of what? The hypostatic union, the fact that he is the God-man. So what this section explains to us so far is the condescension of the Son of God. He lowered himself, the condescension of the Son of God to come to the earth, to die, and then to return in exaltation to glory. It tells us what happened with the divine side of this story, how he was God. He still is God, but he was willing to do something. He was willing to abandon all of his rights for us. That's part of the Christmas message. He was willing to be the giver rather than the receiver. So our Lord actually abandoned his sovereign position. He accepted a slave's place. He associated with sinful people. He adopted a selfless posture. And then he ascended to a supreme prince. Notice that statement. That's a lot of doctrine right there, friends. He abandoned his sovereign position as being God. He abandoned that. He accepted the slave's place. Bad enough he became a member of the human race. That was low enough. But he also took the lowest of low by becoming a slave, by becoming a servant. Then he associated with us, associated with sinful people. Then he adopted this selfless posture. He was willing to give up everything for us and serve us. Finally, he ascended to the supreme title of prince. So let's begin a little bit more with details. I'm not going to get all of these this morning, but let's look at the first one. He abandoned a sovereign position in Philippians 2:6. I want you to see, although he existed in the form of God, he did not regard that equality with God a thing to be grasped. In other words, though he was God, and he pre-existed with the exact essence of God, he did not think, claim in his equality with God something that he wanted. He didn't say, I don't want that. He said, I don't want to claim that. I don't need to claim that. I don't desire to claim that. I'm not even going to profess I am that. What I am going to do is I'm going to reveal to them what it's like to humble yourself and serve God with all your heart and all your soul, and how a member of the human race can do so. So much so that I am going to become just exactly like them and deny myself of all the rights that I have. At any time he could have used his deity, but he was willing to give it up for one reason, because you and I were the joy in Hebrews 12:3 that was set before him. And he says, because we were his joy, he endured the cross and despised the shame. He knew what he was going to go through, but he was willing to abandon his sovereign position. And I like that famous verse, you see, when we understand that. I love that famous verse in 2 Corinthians 8:9, which says, you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was what? Rich. Yet for your sake he became poor. Now here's the paradox. That you, through his poverty, might become what? Rich. The one who was rich became poor so that the poor could become rich, all because of him and who he is. He is the King of Kings. He is the reason why we are here, all because of the King of Kings. You know his grace. So 2 Corinthians 8:9, a staggering verse. Or how about 2 Corinthians 5:21? You take this for granted? He, God the Father. There's a part of the cross that sometimes we forget. We think about the Lord always suffering on the cross, but what was it like to be the Father that had to judge the Son, turn his back on the Son, and hear his Son cry out, Hila, Hila, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me? Over and over again, the Father heard that. What pain he must have gone through. Sometimes we focus in on the pain that our Lord went through, and he sure went through so much pain, it's beyond human imagination. But think about the pain that the Father went through when he had to turn his back upon the Son and forsake his Son. And yet you have people today that can't even give the Father the time of day. God the Father made him, the one who knew no sin, Jesus Christ, to be a sin offering on our behalf. On our behalf. Why? So that we might become the very perfect righteousness of God by being in him. Peter put it like this. For Christ also died for sins, how many times? Once and for who? All. That's the unlimited atonement. He didn't just die for the elect. Christ died for sins one time on the cross and for all, the just for the unjust, in order that he might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh, that's his humanity, suffering a spiritual death, but made alive spiritually. Very important that you understand spiritual death, because that's the death that he died. Why do we die physically if Jesus Christ died for us physically? Why do we die physically? Because that's not the death that he died for us. The death that he died for us was a spiritual death, being separated from God. That's something we will never happen to us. Once we are born again, we are given eternal life, and we will never be separated from God for all of eternity, because he died for us. He died on behalf of us. It was the just for the unjust, so that he could bring us to God. So that first A, he abandoned a sovereign position, is very important. Number two, think about the second one. He accepted a slave's place in Philippians 2, 7 through 8. Again, it does not say he emptied himself of his deity. It says he denied himself of the proper functions of his deity, of his being equal to God, by taking the form of a bondservant, becoming a slave, being made in the likeness of men, or the exact nature of man, minus man's old sin nature. He was willing to accept the slave's place. Are you familiar with that? Are you so familiar with that that you take it for granted? When's the last time you've ever cried and wept thinking about what he actually did for you? Paul said that he cried and wept for three years when it came to dealing with certain Christians and certain pastors in the early church. Because you have to remember, the soul is made up of five parts. And I think this is where a lot of doctrinal churches go off. The soul is made up of five parts. It has a free will. It has a conscience. It has a self-consciousness. It has the ability to think, a mentality. But it also has emotion. And the Bible says we're to worship the Lord our God with all our soul, right? Now, if emotion is a part of the soul, shouldn't we have an emotional response to the Lord Jesus Christ at times? Shouldn't we laugh because we're filled with joy? Shouldn't we cry because we have compassion and tears of joy? There's nothing wrong with being emotional. We don't want the emotions to control our soul. We don't want to be like the holy roll of nuts, you know, running in the aisles, dancing in the spirit, speaking in the language no one can understand. I'm talking about having a legitimate form of response. There's a time for laughter. There's a time for sorrow. There's a time for everything in life. And sometimes doctrinal believers get so involved with the Word of God or Bible doctrine, the teaching, is that they get away from the simplicity of rejoicing. I said to someone just recently, I said, if you won $10 million, what's the first thing that you do? And he said to me, I'd give half to the church. Yeah, right. They always say that, okay? Well, big deal. So you won $5 million, you won 10, so you gave 5 to the church. You still made $5 million out of it, right? But I said, what's the first thing you do? You give it away? I said, no, the first thing you would do is you jump up and down and say, amen, hallelujah, I just won $5-10 million. Wouldn't you be excited? How come Christians don't do that at times? You don't have to do it in church. Please don't do it in church. But, you know, you can do it at times and get excited about the Word of God and rejoice. There's nothing wrong with that. You're worshiping him with all your soul and all your heart. He cried, he wept in John 11:35, the shortest verse in the Bible, says Jesus wept. Of course, he was weeping over Jerusalem because they were rejecting him as they did throughout his lifetime. The point is, he accepted a slave's place. He was willing to accept the place of being a slave. Remember a verse which is extremely humbling for all of us to recognize because of the humility that's behind it. Never become familiar with that verse, like Luke 19:10. Here it is. For the Son of Man has come to what? Seek and to save. That's why he came. To seek and to save who? Those who were lost. He said to the Pharisees, I didn't come for you. You don't need a physician. You're too holy. You're too righteous. You're not sick according to your mind. But he says, I come to seek and save those who are lost. I like how he said in Matthew 20:26, whoever wishes to become great among you shall be your what? Servant. It's a paradox. How do I become great? By being a servant. Doesn't make sense. I thought becoming great was to be someone that is the greatest in everything you do and someone that serves you and people have serving you because you're great. No. To become great in God's eyes with the paradox is this. Whoever wishes to become great among you shall be your servant. Well, the Lord said in Matthew 23:11, but the greatest among you shall be your servant. Look at how people serve, and that will reveal the greatness. He was willing to take the form of a slave. Thirdly, a third A is the word associated. He associated with sinful people, us, which means that we begin to see the depth of his slavery in Philippians 2:7 when it says he was made in the likeness of sin. Here's how the writer of the book of Hebrews put it. He says this, since then the children share in flesh, that's us, we're human, and we have flesh and blood, he himself likewise also partook of the same nature as theirs, minus, of course, the old sin nature. And why did he do that? He had to do that. It goes on to say why he did it. It says, since then the children share in the flesh and blood, he himself likewise also partook of the same nature as theirs, in order that through his spiritual death or his being separated from God, he might render powerless him who had the power of death. And who has the power of death? That is who? The devil. Now, how does the devil have the power of death? He can't go around killing anyone he wants. He has the power of death because he has the power to transfer his thoughts to members of the human race. And the average member of the human race lives in fear of death. So he puts them in bondage. The older you get, all of a sudden death becomes more and more of a reality. The hot burn is no longer agita, as we say in the Italians say agita, or it's no longer hot burn. It's a heart attack. Every time you have a problem, it's a major, it's got to be cancer, it's got to be this. Why? You're living in fear, your fear of the unknown. The devil keeps people in bondage through fear. It's one of his greatest weapons. But Jesus Christ said, I'm going to give you victory over that fear. I'm going to give you victory because the death that you're going to be afraid, the death that you really are going to fear is being separated from the Father forever. And you'll never have that happen to you, providing you have believed in me as your Lord and Savior. I will associate with you and become just like you. And do not forget, when the Bible again talks about Jesus Christ dying for your sins, it's talking about separation from God. Think about it. It's very simple. If the Lord Jesus Christ died a physical death for us or in place of us, then why would we die physically? If he died for us, don't say you're going to do something for me, then I have to do it. Don't say you're going to do it in place of me, then I have to do it again. So it can't be a physical death because everybody dies physically with the exception of the rapture generation. But if he died spiritually for us, and he did, and in place of us, it's never going to happen. I like how the Apostle Paul put it in Colossians 2:14-16, where he says that we had a debt that we couldn't pay. We owed God perfection. No one could pay it. No one has in their bank account, or no one has in their resources, or their escrow blessing, and their escrow account. No one has the ability to pay the debt. I've always liked that song we sing periodically here. He paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sins away. And now I sing a brand new song. Amazing grace, Christ Jesus paid a debt that I could never pay. Isn't that great? Come on now. That's a great Christmas present. Our Lord paid a debt so we would never have to pay. It simply makes no sense at all. It's not a paradox. This is a fact. He was willing to associate with sinful people, which is why he was called. What was one of the titles? Jesus Christ was called a lot of things, but one of the titles I like the most, because it identifies me with him, is he is said to be, again, he was called a friend of tax gatherers and sinners. By the way, the word sinners doesn't even mean sinners. There's actually the word for prostitutes. The tax gatherers were considered to be the worst male sinners in Israel because they would collect taxes from the Jews and give it to the Romans and make a percentage of doing that. And then the prostitutes were known for being immoral. But Jesus Christ was said to be a friend of tax gatherers and sinners. What it does say is that he is going to evaluate our works, not judge us. You see, when we say he's a friend of sinners, then people say, does he condone sin? Isn't God going to judge me for my sin? No. What the Bible does say is that he's going to evaluate our works, not judge us for our sins. In 1 Corinthians 3:11-15, 2 Corinthians 5:10. So we're going to stand before God, but not to be judged for our sins. Why? He's a friend of sinners. and he died for sinners. He associated with sinners, and he did it for us. That's what the first Christmas was all about. God becoming man. God becoming humanity so that you and I could now have this fantastic life because of everything that he did for us by becoming one of us. In fact, he did so much for us that we were originally created lower than the angels. But Hebrews chapter 1 and 2 says he elevated us now higher than the angels, which is why angels are said to be called our ministering spirits, spirits that minister to us. We're not guardians for the angels. The angels are guardians for us. Why? They serve us because we've been elevated higher than all angels through our union with the Lord Jesus Christ. Then number 4, we have that word adopted. He adopted or assumed a selfless posture. Number 4, a selfless posture. Look at what it says in verse 8. Being found in appearance as a man, here's his selfless posture. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even the death on the cross. How selfless? Willing to adopt a selfless posture. Saying, you know what? I'm going to humble myself and I'll do whatever it takes to save them. And I always like to say, if there was just only one that needed to be saved, he would have come and died that spiritual death. If trillions and trillions of people could have kept themselves totally holy and perfect, and just one was lost, he would have become a man just for that one. As the song says, for only one, he would have come. That's our King. That's our Lord. That's our Savior. That's the reason why we are here. That's the reason why we are alive. That's the reason why we serve. That's the reason why we learn, because of who and what he is. Then finally, number 5, not only did he abandon the sovereign position, not only did he accept a slave's place, not only did he approach a sinful people, not only did he adopt a selfless posture, finally, he ascended to be a supreme prince. He now took the reward. Why? It was a part of God's plan. God did all of this. He didn't say, I'm doing this to get this position. God said to reward you for your faithfulness because you have pleased me and you are my beloved son in whom I am well pleased in. I am now going to elevate you to a place where all angels and all humans will bow down and worship you. And then the ones who don't want to bow down and worship you are going to bow down before you and acknowledge that you're King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Even if they're in hell, they're going to be forced to do so. That the unbeliever and the fallen angels will one day have to acknowledge and confess Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Verses 9 through 11, he ascended to a supreme prince. Then it says, for this reason also. What reason? The reason of his submission, the reason of his humiliation, the reason of his obedience to death, even the death of the cross. Because these are the reasons he submitted, he was humiliated, he humbled himself, he obeyed, and he even died the death of the cross. For this reason, God elevated him to that higher place because he perfectly obeyed the Father. He accomplished redemption, and because of that, God highly exalted him. God raised him from the dead, as the New Testament tells us. He raised him from the dead. And I love that because God raised him from the dead as a sign of the fact of God's satisfaction over his death. And then God exalted him to his own right hand. God bestowed on him the name or the title which is above every name or every title. So he abandoned his sovereign position. Think about that. All because of what? Because of who and what he is. I want to read to you something as I get ready to close. But just bear with me as I turn to the end of my notes here, because I know I've got 66 pages and I'm not going to get to all of them, so I might as well just go to exactly where I want to go. But I want you to just listen as I close with this particular part of the service. Listen very carefully. He's not just a man, but the God-man. He stands in a class all his own. He's the miracle of miracles. He is self-sufficient. He is eternal. He is immortal. He is all-powerful, he's all-knowing, he is everywhere present, yet he's also within us. He's the only Savior, he's the one who forgives sins, he is the one who gives life, he is the one who raises the dead, he sustains, He creates, he rules, he elects, he redeems, he reconciles, he justifies, he sanctifies, he glorifies. He's the King of kings, he's the Lord of lords. He is the King of the Jews, he's the King of Israel, he's the King of righteousness, he's the King of the ages, he's the King of heaven, he's the King of glory, he's the King of kings, he's the Lord of lords. He's enduringly strong. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's impartially powerful. And he is God's son. He's the sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He stands alone in himself. He is unique. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He's supreme. He's preeminent. He's the miracle of the ages. He's the only one able to supply all of our needs. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted. He sympathizes and he saves. He guards and he guides. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captives. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He rewards the aged. His rewards are for the diligent. He beautifies the meek. He's the wellspring of wisdom. He's the doorway of deliverance. He's the pathway of peace. He's the roadway of righteousness. He's the highway of holiness. He's the gateway of glory. He's the master of the mighty. He's the captain of the conquerors. He's the head of the heroes. He's the leader of the legislators. He's the overseer of the overcomers. He's the governor of governors. He's the prince of princes. He's the king of kings. He's the lord of lords. His office is manifold. His promise is sure. His life is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. His yoke is easy. His burden is light. He's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. He is.
He's sovereign. Ezra, a true and faithful scribe. And Nehemiah, he's the rebuilder of broken walls and lives. And Esther, he's Mordecai's courage. And Job, the timeless redeemer. In the Psalms, he is our morning song. In Proverbs, wisdom's cry. Ecclesiastes, the time and season. In the Song of Solomon, he is the lover's dream. He is, he is, he is. In Isaiah, he's the Prince of Peace. Jeremiah, the weeping prophet. the cry for Israel. Ezekiel, he's the call from sin. And Daniel, the stranger in the fire. In Hosea, he is forever faithful. In Joel, he is the Spirit's power. In Amos, the arms that carry us. In Obadiah, he's the Lord our Savior. In Jonah, he is the great missionary. In Micah, the promise of peace. In Nahum, he is our strength and our shield. In Habakkuk and Zephaniah, he's pleading for revival.
In Haggai, he restores a lost heritage.
In Zechariah, our fountain. In Malachi, he's the son of righteousness, rising with healing in his wings.
He is, he is, he is.
In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, he is God, man, Messiah. In the book of Acts, he is the fire from heaven. In Romans, he's the grace of God. In Corinthians, the power of love. In Galatians, he is freedom from the curse of sin. Ephesians, our glorious treasure. Philippians, the servant's heart. In Colossians, he's the Godhead Trinity. Thessalonians, our coming King. And Timothy, Titus, Philemon, he's our mediator and our faithful pastor. In Hebrews, the everlasting covenant. In James, the one who heals the sick. In 1st and 2nd Peter, he is our shepherd. In John and in Jude, he's the lover coming for his bride. In the Revelation, he is King of kings and Lord of lords. He is, he is, he is.
All 66 books, and each book was manifested by the main statement that the book was all about. And we're going to close this part of our service right now with the time for our altar call. So if anyone would like, if everyone would just bow their heads right now, please do so. And Father, we do come before you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you because of who he is. And Father, we dedicate the closing moments of our service this morning to anyone who's listening to our broadcast or listening to this message, that will hear this message in the future, maybe even in the tribulation period, wherever it may be, whenever needed, Father, that if there's anyone that would like to take this time to tell you, forming the sentences in thought only, that they recognize that they are a sinner and that they recognize that they need a Savior and that right now they're willing to believe upon your Son, Jesus Christ, to have eternal life. For your word says, believe in the Lord Jesus and you can be saved. So if anyone's doing that right now, and you're forming these sentences right now and telling God in your own way, you're trusting in His Son, Jesus Christ, that you are believing upon Him with all your heart for Him to be your Lord and your Savior, you may do so. And in doing so, you have now just received eternal life. So easy, so simple, because it was so difficult and hard for Him to attain. If it's by grace we have been saved, it's through faith. It's not of our works, lest any man should boast. Thank you so much for this morning. Thank you for all that went on. And Father, we ask your blessing to be upon the remainder of this service this morning. We ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our precious Lord and Savior. He is. Amen. Thank you, Father. Thank you, congregation. I'd like to have Deacon.